So now let's ask this question. How do we represent a joint distribution? How do we represent a joint distribution? We've already done it in the past 20 minutes. Okay. Right. So we'll just look at that. So that's the question, and it's good that some of you already realize it. It's just that the question is asked in a way that it's not very obvious, but we all of us have regularly or routinely done this. Okay. So let us return to the case of n variables, and for simplicity assume that each of these variables can take binary values, right? Yes, no, high, low, and so on. Okay. And to specify the joint distribution, and that's what the part of the recap was focusing on, if I have to give you this joint distribution, how many values do I have to give you? N variables, each of them is binary. If I have to give you a joint distribution, how many values do I have to give you? 2 power n minus 1. Why minus 1? Yeah, it's obvious. So if it's not obvious, it will come on the next slide, right? It always is there on the slide. So why not 2 raised to n, and why 2 raised to n minus 1? It doesn't matter. One value is not going to create a lot of difference. So if we specify these 2 raised to n minus 1 values, that's the representation of the joint distribution, right? That's how I choose to represent the joint distribution. I'll give you a table. I'll just put a value for every possible outcome in that joint distribution. That means every possible combination of assignment to all the variables involved in the joint distribution, and that's the representation, right? Is that fair? Right. So that's what I mean by representation. Okay. Now, what's the problem with this explicit representation, where I specify all the 2 raised to n minus 1 variables? So I'll tell you, there are three problems, and you tell me what do I mean by each of these three words. One is computational, the other is cognitive, the third is statistical. Computational, what's the problem? Just storing this table in your database or whatever is going to be a challenge, right? What's the cognitive problem? Okay, interpreting is one. Who is going to give you this table? Who is going to give you this table? So think of one situation, right? Again, let's be practical and think of the oil drilling case, right? Maybe there are some experts in the company who know with various years of experience that how these things, variables interact with each other, and just pull out numbers from their head, right? Okay, I think this looks like 0.03 probability, this looks like 0.02, and so on. And actually, for small scale problems, you can imagine that something like this is done, right? If you just have 4 or 5 variables, you could actually write it down. But as the value of n increases, what's going to happen? It's going to become impossible to acquire these tables or these values from humans. No human is going to be able to give you that. If humans can't do it, who will do it? So now how will machines do it actually? They learn from humans. They learn from data. So that brings me to the third part. What's the statistical problem? How many parameters do you need to learn? 2 power n. More the number of parameters, more data, right? So really learn these 2 raised to n values, you'll need more and more data, right? Otherwise, whatever you learn is not going to be statistically significant, right? Because you have these 2 raised to n possible entries in your table, you at least see each of these entries 100 times to be able to figure out what their probabilities are, right? And just seeing them once itself is a challenge. How will you get so much data? Okay, so these are the three problems, right? You have cognitive, computational, as well as statistical problems. So this representation, although a valid representation, has its own set of problems, right? You can't really, even though this representation is fine, you can't really represent the joint distribution like this, because it's going to be too many values. You can't really do this representation, right?